Hello students, welcome to this lecture 10 on calculus of variations. In this lecture, basically we are going to discuss the fundamental lemmas of the calculus of variation. There are mainly four lemmas regarding calculus of variations, and one of them is useful for the derivation of the Euler equation. So this is the statement of the first lemma. This is most important one over here, and rest of those are depending on this. So statement of this lemma is, if we have this a function, we have a function mx belongs to CAB. CAB means the collection of all continuous functions on the interval AB. And if you are given the condition that the integral from a to b mx eta x dx is equal to 0 for every nx belongs to c1ab. Here, what is meaning of this c1ab? C1ab is the collection of all functions which have first order derivative in the interval a to b. Means whose first order derivative exists in the interval a to b, such that eta of a and eta of b equal to 0, then you have to prove that mx equal to 0 for all x belongs to a b. So you can remember the statement of this lemma. Now the proof of this lemma can be obtained by contradiction. Contradiction means here you have to prove that this mx equal to 0. But you will consider the opposite thing, that you will consider that mx is not equal to 0, and by then obtaining some contradictory situation, then you can say that this supposition is wrong and therefore this mx must be equal to 0. So this is the methodology of proof of this lemma. So first we suppose that, if possible, suppose that mx is non-zero. When this is non-zero, either it will be negative or positive. So this is your choice. You can take anything, any of the case. So without loss of generality, we can consider that mx is positive, that mx is greater than 0 at some point in this interval AB. Right. Mx must then, by continuity, be positive in some interval x1, x2 within AB. That means we are considering that mx is greater than, here we are, suppose this is curve for mx and mx is greater than 0 at some point x, and that x is in the interval x1, x2, and this is itself contained in the interval a to b. So then you can see here we consider eta x in such a way that it has its values outside this interval x1, x2, outside this interval x1, x2, the value is 0. The eta x is 0 beyond x1, and here eta x is also 0 beyond this x2. So in this part, so if we consider this type of the curve, then we can take any function we can define by our choice. Suppose we are defining it like this, x minus x1, it is better to choose and easy to choose. And x minus x2 square, in this situation definitely this eta is greater than 0, and for rest of the situation, means outside this interval x1 x2, the value of eta x comes out to be 0. If we are considering this eta x in this manner, you can see this eta x is clearly differentiable. It has first order of derivative. So with this choice of theta, because in our statement, we are given that eta must be a function whose first order differential is differential exists. So in this situation, we must consider eta in such a way that its first order derivative exists. But the natural question that comes to the mind is that, so this theorem will be true only for one value of eta x, or one such a choice of eta x? No, it is not the case, because we are going to prove it in general that mx equal to 0. So we are taking that mx is not equal to 0. That means it is positive without loss of generality at some point. If it is not equal to 0, it can be negative and in certain part and it can be positive in certain part. And here we are considering that this case when mx is greater than 0 at some point. So definitely we are taking some point, and if result is true, then it must be true for every point and for every this kind of the situation. So that is why if we take any eta of this satisfying this condition, that is which is having first order of derivative, then whole thing should hold. So in this way, if we are taking this eta x, and definitely you have to keep in mind this value. If we are taking this way, then you can see that if we differentiate it, eta x will exist, and therefore eta x belongs to C1AV. So eta x is satisfying the given condition of the lemma. Now with this choice of eta x, integral this a to b mx eta x dx can be written like this, x1 to x2. Why we are writing x1 to x2? Because beyond x1 and x2, the value of eta x is 0, as here it is given. Okay, when you move on to this part of interval here, x2 to b, the value is 0. X1 to a to x1, this is also 0. So if there is some value, that definitely that will be in the interval x1 to x2. So that is why we are taking this value, a to b can be written as x1 to x2 mx, and we are putting the value of eta x for the part x1 to x2, because for the remaining part the value of eta x is 0. That is why we write this integral in this form. Now clearly we have already considered that this is non-negative. This is definitely non-negative. It is square quantity, non-negative. It is also square quantity, non-negative. When the whole integrand is non-negative, that means you can say this integral in left hand side is greater than 0. But this contradicts to our original hypothesis. We are in our original hypothesis, or in the statement of the lemma, we are given that the value of integral a to b mx eta x dx is equal to 0, but here it is coming out to be greater than 0. So this is a contradiction to our original hypothesis, and therefore we can say that our choice of mx not equal to 0 is wrong, because in the beginning of the proof we have considered that mx is not equal to 0, and because of this choice we are getting a contradictory situation to our given hypothesis, because in our given hypothesis we are given that the value of this integral is equal to 0, but here we are getting it is greater than 0. So that way we can say our choice is wrong, therefore mx must be equal to 0 for all x in the interval a to b. Now since mx is a continuous function, this is also given in the statement of the lemma, it means it vanishes at the end points of the interval, and therefore mx equal to 0. Here this is 0 within the open interval, and this is also vanishing at the end points. So you can say that mx equal to 0 for all x in the interval a to b. So this completes the proof of this lemma. Now the second lemma, fundamental lemma, is if mx belongs to CAB, mx is a continuous function on the interval AB, and this integral a to b mx eta dash x. So here is some change. In place of eta x, this was in the first lemma, it was eta x. Now here is eta dash x equal to 0. And again, eta x is differentiable. It has first order derivative c1. If it would have been c2, then means second order derivatives exist here. So here first order derivative of eta x exists, such that eta a eta b equal to 0. So these are the given conditions. Then you have to show that mx equal to c, where c is a constant. C is a constant for all x belong to a b. Means you have to show this situation. In the last case we have shown that mx equal to 0, but in that case in the first lemma, in place of eta x, here it was eta x. So to prove this lemma again, as in the earlier case, we have chosen eta x in such a way that was satisfying these conditions. Now again here we consider eta x in such a way that we can prove this lemma. So to prove this lemma, therefore we should have a proper choice of the variation eta x this function eta x. Right. So now, to get an appropriate eta x, what we do? We are given that mx is a continuous function on the interval ab. On the interval ab. If mu is the mean value of the function mx on interval ab, then we can write by mean value theorem that value, the mean value is given by 1 minus b upon a integral a to b mx dx. So that is how you get the mean value of this function mx on the interval ab. Let this equation number 11. Further, this is simple calculation work, that if we write 1 upon b minus a integral a to b and mu is definitely a constant quantity, then you can write it as 1 upon b minus a, mu can take an outside and integral of dx is x, and you are putting up lower limit and upper limit. Consequently, you are getting b minus a. Now this b minus a will be cancelled with this b minus a. The only thing is mu. So that means in place of mu, you can write this thing. Okay, now this value of mu can be substituted over here, over here. Consequently, equation 11 reduces to this form. The further simplification, when we cancel out this one and this one, we are getting this equation. Now further, from this equation, if we take integrals on one side, then we get equation number 12. So why we are doing it? Because we want to get an appropriate eta x, the variation eta x, this is eta x, such that that satisfies the given conditions, and so that we are able to prove the main result of the lemma. Fine. So we consider eta x in such a way. A to x integral x mu minus nu. Nu means that mean value, and this is du. Suppose you are taking eta x. Now we want to check whether this choice of eta x is appropriate or not. Means whether this eta x is an admissible function to proceed ahead as per the conditions of the lemma. So what were the given conditions? The conditions of lemma were that value of eta at point A and B is 0. Moreover, eta x has first order of derivative. That means it belongs to C1. AB on the interval, this, that is first order derivative exists in the interval AB. So now we want to check both these conditions. We want to check both these conditions for eta x. So you see, from equation 13, if I write in place of x, if I am writing a here, then what do we get? Now the value, the upper limit of integral becomes a, because we are placing x with a, so a to a mu nu du. If upper and lower limit are same, the value is 0. So definitely eta a equal to 0. Now we check whether this eta b is equal to 0 or not. So let us see. Now we are putting eta b here. So upper limit becomes b. Fine. Now you can see this left hand side seems to be constant here. But now what happens in right hand side? Right hand side is an integral in terms of variable u. And in a definite integral, variable can be changed, because such a variable is called a dummy variable. We can change. Instead of u, you can write x, and definitely for u, you will write dx. Now this thing is nothing but the equation number 12. In equation number 12, the value of this integral is given to be 0. So in this way, eta b comes out to be 0. So finally, what we have obtained, we have already obtained that eta a equal to 0, and now here we have obtained eta b equal to 0. So you can say eta a equal to eta b equal to 0. One of the given condition is satisfied by eta x. Now let us check the second condition. And now what is the second condition? Second condition was that eta x is such a function whose first order derivative exists. That means that belongs to the class CAB. Okay, so now the value of eta x is given in equation number 13. Now we are taking differentiation on both sides, derivative of this both side with respect to x. So what we are getting, d by dx of eta x and d by dx of eta x of this integral. So now how to integrate, how to take the differentiation of an integral in which limits are variable. So because here x is variable, is constant. So we can apply the rule of differentiation under integral sign in right hand side of this equation number 14. So what is that rule? We have already discussed in our earlier lectures. So again, you can see the example here. Now, from equation 14, in left hand side, derivative of this eta x, you can write eta dash x. Now, how you operate the right hand side? That means, what is the rule of differentiation under integral sign? You see, eta dash x equal to, the rule is like this. The d by dx inside goes in, outside, d by dx outside of the integral goes inside and it becomes the partial derivative, curly by curly x of the integrand, whatever is given there. Yes. And in fact, this is u. This is u. Fine. Further, we take partial derivative of the upper limit, curly x by curly x with respect to x. And whatever integrand was given in this integrand, you put the value of variable as the upper limit, because here upper limit is x, so you will write here x minus mu. Then minus of partial derivative of the lower limit, so that gives curly a by curly x. And again, whatever integrand was given already, in that integrand you will put value of the lower limit in place of the variable. So you will put here variable is u, so it becomes m of a here and minus mu. Now a is constant, so partial derivative of a with respect to x is 0, so 0 is here and this quantity as it is, and curly x by curly x is 1 and this quantity as it is. Further, in this part there is no x. When there is no x, that means partial derivative of this with respect to x is 0. So ultimately we are left with this term only. This term only, this is 0 and the last term is also 0. So consequently eta dash x, this eta dash x equal to mx minus mu. So you can say the first order derivative of eta x exists in the interval. So we are calling this as equation 15. So you can say eta x belongs to c1ab. This is the second given condition regarding eta x. This is given in the statement. Thus you can say the variation eta x considered in equation 13 is appropriate. Means we can take such a value of eta x as it is satisfying all the conditions which are given in the statement of the lemma. Now, what was our aim? Our aim was that with the given conditions, we have to show that mx equal to some constant. Fine. So by the given hypothesis, it was given in the statement that integral a to b mx eta dash x dx is equal to 0. But here we have obtained certain value of eta dash x, and that is using equation 15. You can put the value over here. So you can say from this whole computational work, you can say a to b mx mx minus nu dx equal to 0. Let this is equation number 16. Now using equation 12 again, in equation 12 we are given that this integral mx minus mu dx equal to 0, but if we multiply this with mu, mu is a constant quantity, again it will be 0. So I can say that this is equation number 17. Now subtracting equation number 17 from equation number 16, so we get this type of situation. When we simplify this, we are getting this. Further simplification leads to this term, and ultimately it becomes integral of ab mx minus mu square dx equal to 0. Yes. Now recall the fact, what we had to prove over here. We have to show that mx equal to c, the constant quantity for all x in the interval ab. But now up to the equation number 18, what we are getting, the value of integral ab mx minus mu square dx coming out to be 0. Now you see, by the geometrical interpretation of a definite integral, if I consider that this is some function yx, that y equal to mx minus mu square, then in definite integral between two limits a to b gives the area under this curve. That means it means that the area under this curve is 0, and the curve is positive, is in the positive direction. So that way, mx minus mu is a non-negative function, and the area under the curve is zero. Area under the curve can be zero only when the whole curve is overlapping with x-axis. It can happen only when the whole curve is nothing but the x-axis, that is y equal to zero. Y equal to zero means this whole, because we have considered y equal to this thing. That means we have to keep mx minus mu square equal to zero. Mx minus mu square equal to zero, and that will give us mx minus mu square equal to 0 implies mx equal to mu, and mu is a constant quantity. If it is a constant, we can consider that mu equal to c. So mx equal to c for all x belongs to ab. So this completes the proof of this lemma. Now the third lemma. Third lemma is we have mx belongs to cab in a continuous function on the closed interval ab, satisfying this condition. Again, you see here, what is the difference from the first and second? In this situation, in the first lemma it was eta x, in the second lemma it was eta dash, now in the third lemma is eta double dash. Since there is involvement of double dash, so definitely you need to have eta x in such a way whose second order derivatives exist, because it belongs to C2AB. C2AB stands for the class of those functions whose second order derivative are continuously differentiable. You can say, or second order derivative exist in a very simple terms, you can say. And satisfying this condition, eta A, eta B equal to eta dash A, eta dash B equal to zero. Then we have to prove that mx equal to c naught plus c1x for suitable constants c1 and c2. So what you can say about c naught and c1? So definitely, again, the choice of eta x is important. How to consider this eta x so that it satisfies all these conditions, and then by certain computations we can get the result, this value mx equal to c naught plus c1x. So you can try this, you can form this. Otherwise I will give you a hint in further lectures. So this is all about this lecture. The main reference regarding this lecture is, this is very important book here, First Course in Calculus of Variation, and it is a book published by American Mathematical Society. Thank you.